Thank you for attending and thank you for inviting me. I will present you shortly a formalism that we call string graphs and link streams that we introduced recently in my team in Leipzig in Jussieu for modeling interactions over time. So we are interested in interactions between objects and we want to take account of time, the time dynamics. So let me start with a simple example of the kind of objects we are considering. We want to, here in this example, we want to observe the interactions between six individuals that we define, that we model as six nodes A, B, C, D, E, and F. And we observe them during a time period of, in this example, 24 minutes that I represent on the horizontal axis. Okay? So first thing is that the nodes are not always present. The individuals are not always in the room where I observe them. So there is a dynamics on unknowns. And in this example, for instance, A is present in the room from time 0 to time 8. Then it leaves the room, and it comes back at time 12 and stays in the room until the end. Okay? And all nodes enter the room and leave the room in this way. Then there are interactions between these nodes, of course. For instance, here, there is an interaction between A and C from time 2 to time 6, and another interaction between E and F from time 0 to time 4, other interactions, and others, okay? So this is the kind of objects I'm interested in, and I will study in this talk. So why am I interested in this kind of data? Actually, because it's quite pervasive. There are some such data quite everywhere. And if you think a little about it, you will see that many of the data you are actually considering are not really graphs, but there are sequence of interactions like this. Like, for instance, users listening to music on Deezer. It happens at a specific time. It lasts for a given time period, and then it ends. So I've listed here a large set of typical examples, including sales, network traffic, data transfers, contact between individuals, phone calls, messages, contracts, mobility, marriages, function calls in programs, chemical interactions like protein interactions, etc., etc. So many situations where this kind of data occurs. And of course, as a consequence, they are important for many applications like network design, software optimization, medicine, epidemiology, recommender systems, as we have seen, anomaly detections, and many other applications. And another important point while we are looking at this kind of data is that there are more and more such data available because of the recording of many interaction traces in many websites, mobile phones, and so on. And the question we ask is how to describe such data in a quite precise sense. For instance, when I give you a large graph with millions of nodes and links, I ask you what it looks like. I ask you to describe it. Then you're able to describe it in a way that I understand. You will compute its density, maybe clusters, maybe clustering coefficient, maybe degree distributions, etc. So you have a wide set of notions, of concepts, that makes it possible for you to describe a graph. And we want to do the same thing as, with interaction streams. So what is usually done when you have to deal with such data? Well, basically, until recently, you had two choices. You could forget about the dynamics, forget about time, and focus on the structure. So you forget the time dynamics, and you aggregate all interactions into a graph, and you can describe the graph, as I said just before. Okay, and symmetrical approach, a dual approach, is to forget about the structure and just look at the number of interactions per time unit. So you focus on the dynamics, and then you forget about the structure. So of course, this has really huge advantages because if you obtain a graph, then you have all the graph tools that you know that you can apply to describe your data. And if you forget about the structure and focus on the dynamics, you have all signal analysis tools and the time series tools that you can use to describe the dynamics. But of course, in both situations, you lose either the dynamics or the structure, so it's not really satisfactory. So what people do for a few years now, it became quite classical. You divide the time into slices, and then you obtain one graph for each time slice. So here, for instance, I divided the time into four slices, and I obtain a sequence of four graphs. And then I try to describe both the structure and the dynamics of the data by describing the dynamics of the structure of these graphs. Okay. So this is quite classical, but this raises several serious issues. First of all, you lose a lot of information. As I said before, if you focus on a graph, you lose the dynamics. If you focus on the dynamics, then you lose the structure. But if you divide the time into slices, you also lose a lot of information, because inside each slice, you lose the dynamics. So this is one problem. Another problem is that when you divide the time into slices, you don't know how to choose slices, because if you have small slices, you have little information inside each slice, so the graphs will be trivial. If you have large slices, then you will lose much information inside each slice, so it's very difficult. And actually, there are already many papers dealing just with the question of how to choose appropriate time slices. And the conclusion is, in general, that there are many of them, then you should choose different slices at different time periods, maybe different slices for different nodes groups. So actually, the conclusion is, in general, that there is not one or even a small set of good choices. Another problem that is less discussed, but in my opinion it's at least as important, is the fact that when you have divided the time into slices and when you obtained a graph sequence, well, you have to study a graph sequence. And although you are very good in dealing with one graph, we don't know, there is no general theory on how to describe a graph sequence. Of course, there are many clever techniques that have been developed, but there is no one global way of doing so. So, because of these issues, many people try to develop other techniques that avoid information loss and avoid dividing time into slices. So, in particular, I just cite a few of them. In particular, some colleagues work on what is called TVG for time-varying graphs, where they label each node and each link with their time presence. So, there is no loss of information in this case. Other colleagues duplicate nodes for each time slice. No, not really time slice, but for each time where there is an event. So they construct a big graph like this. Some of them call them temporal graphs or multi-aspect graphs, MAGs. And in all these approaches, there is no loss of information, so it's a very good point. But it's still graph-oriented, in the sense that with these approaches, you tend to think of the data as a graph that evolves over time, not as a stream of events, a stream of interactions. So it's not completely satisfactory from our point of view. And there are also many ad hoc properties that are introduced in various papers, in particular in physics and in networking, about temporal networks, mostly path-related, because reachability is a key concern in networking and in epidemiology, mainly. And many notions are already defined on these objects, but there is no, again, general vision of these properties. And based on these previous works, what we wanted to do and what we propose is to develop a theory to deal directly with the stream of interaction. So we don't want to transform the data that we call stream graphs and link streams. I will detail it right after this. We don't want to transform the data into a graph or into a time series. On the contrary, what we do is, it's very similar, but completely different. we take graph theory or network science and we transform it into a theory of stream graphs and link streams. And likewise, we take signal analysis notions, concepts, and time series concepts, and we transform them into concepts dealing with stream graphs and link streams directly. Okay, so saying this is quite easy, but we don't want to do this in any way. We want to fit a set of wanted features, some of them informal and some of them more precise. First, we want the formalism to be as simple and intuitive as possible. This means that when I give you a graph and give you a description of this graph, I don't have to spend hours or days explaining you what it means. It's quite easy to understand the density, the degree, these notions, for instance. And we want to have the same kind of intuition on the object, although it's informal, of course. We want this theory, this set of concepts to be as comprehensive as possible, meaning that we want the previous notions, the notions that have been introduced in previous papers, to be we want the theory to be able to define, to redefine these notions, these concepts. We want it to be consistent with respect to time and nodes. We don't want to have a focus of nodes or on time. We really want to mix the both together. And I will not have the time to detail this, but it's an important feature of our approach. And we want the theory to generalize graphs and signals. And I will explain more precisely what I mean with this later. So let me enter in the technical part of the talk by giving first the definition of what we call a string graph. I just recall that a graph is just defined by a set of nodes and links, each link being a pair of distinct nodes, an ordered pair of distinct nodes in this presentation. So a string graph is defined by four sets. A first set T, that is a time interval, a node set V, and a set W that represents the time presence of nodes, so the dynamics on nodes. W is a subset of T times V, and TV is in W means that V is present in the stream at time T. Okay, so nothing complex here. Just a remark, when you have a time interval XY, and xy times v is included in w, it means that v is present from time x to time y. Okay, because tv is in w for each t in xy. Just a notation, capital tv is the set of time instant at which v is present in the stream. Okay, so tv is just the set of times at which v is present. And the fourth set defining a stream graph is the set of links, E. And the set, it's a subset of T cross T times V times V. And similarly to W, T UV is in E, if and only if, it means that U and V are linked at time T. Okay? So we have the same remark with intervals. And capital T UV is the set of time instant at which U and V are linked together, so T U V is in E. Okay, just a simple example, but I will not detail everything. So I give you an example of stream graph here, and with full details. So T is the time interval 0, 10. The set of nodes V is A, B, C, D. And in W, you have, for instance, 4, 9 times C, because C is present for time 4 to time 9. Okay, and equivalently, TC is equal to 4,9. And you have the same here in blue for the link between B and C from time 6 to time 9. So before going further, just a few remarks from this definition already. First, if you have a link between two nodes at a given time instant, then the two nodes have to be present in the stream at this time instant, of course. You can't have a link between two nodes that are not in the stream. So TUV is in E requires that TU and TV are in W. Okay, so this is just a first remark for the definition, a constraint on the definition. Another remark that I will not have the time to detail, but we can discuss it later if you want, is that what I will present and the definition itself works with discrete time or continuous time, and it works with instantaneous interactions and interaction with durations. Okay, the interactions I presented here have a duration, and they may also have a zero duration, so be instantaneous. And the formalism also works with directed links, with weighted links, with bipartite links, with, of course, the same kind of adaptations as in graphs. Now, just a little definition on specific case, just a piece of vocabulary. When I have no dynamics on nodes, which means that for all V, for all node, TV, the set of time presence of V, is the whole T, then the string graph has no dynamics on node, and we call it a link stream. Okay, and it's defined only by three sets, T, V, and E. You don't need W anymore, of course. Going further, if there is no dynamics on node and no dynamics on links, meaning that each link is present either all the time or never, In other words, TUV for all UV is either the whole T or the empty set. Then the string graph is equivalent to a graph. There is no dynamics on nodes, there is no dynamics on links. So the object is strictly equivalent to a graph. And this gives a formal ground to my requirement that our theory must generalize graphs. Because what do we mean with this idea of generalization? Well, when we have a stream with no dynamics, that we call a graph equivalent stream, a stream where nodes are always present and links also, when we have an object like this, which is equivalent to a graph, then we want the properties that we define on the stream to be equal to the properties of the graph. Okay, so in this sense, the properties of the stream generalizes properties of graphs. So this is something we ensure, we check every time we define a property. So now maybe the most basic property that we can define about an object or a graph or a string graph is its size. So when you have a string graph like this, you may be tempted to say that there are four nodes. But the first node, A, is present for the whole duration of the stream, 10 time units here, and the node D is present only for 2 times units. So maybe you don't want to count them the same way. So what we do is that we introduce the notion of a fractional number of nodes. Each node contributes to the size of the stream proportionally to its time presence. Okay, we just say that the number of nodes is the sum for all nodes of its time, the fraction of time it's present. So it gives, in this example, a fractional number of nodes of 2.6. And we do the same with the number of links. A link that is present all the time will count for 1. A link that is present half the time will count for 1/2, and so on. I'm just defining a few very basic properties of string graphs that I will use later to define more elaborate properties of interest. But actually, I don't know if you've noticed, but in graph concepts, in general, the most subtle concepts are just defined from the very basic ones. So what we are doing is we define very cautiously the basic concepts, and then we use them to define more elaborate ones. So the size of a stream graph is one of the most basic and the most important concepts, of course. The clusters and the substream is another key concept. In a graph, a cluster is just a subset of nodes. So I know there are other notions of concepts, but I just define a cluster as a subset of V, a set of nodes. And in a stream graph, we define a cluster as a subset of W, meaning that we take some of the nodes at some of the times where they are present in the stream. So here you have the cluster C that is in green in this stream graph. Okay, so I take A from time 0 to 2, B from time 0 to 2, and then from time 6 to 10, etc. Okay, nothing complicated here. And from the notion of cluster, we define the substream induced by the cluster. So S of C is the substream induced by C, and it's just defined on the same time period, the same node set. Now the nodes are present only when they are present in C, and I take links between nodes only when they are present in C. So in my example here, we obtain this subgraph. And this is very important because many properties of graphs are actually defined as properties of subgraphs induced by clusters. So I will do the same in streams. I will define properties of streams as properties of substreams induced by their clusters. The first example is the degree and the neighborhood that is defined as a cluster. Okay, in a graph J, the neighborhood of a node V is just the set of nodes linked to it. In a string graph, I just say that the neighborhood of a node V is the set of nodes linked to V at the times where they are linked to V. Okay, so for instance here, when I take node D here, the neighborhood of D is just the set of nodes, the cluster formed by the nodes linked to D at the times when they are linked to D. So it's the green cluster. Okay. And because the neighborhood in graphs and in streams is a cluster, I can consider the substream induced by this cluster and define many properties this way. One of the most important one is clearly the degree, which is nothing but the size of the neighborhood in a graph. So in a stream, I have a notion of size, I have a notion of neighborhood. So I just say that it's the same thing. I just say that in streams, like in graphs, the degree of a node is the size of its neighborhood. So for instance here, I have already shown the neighborhood of D. The degree of D is the size of its neighborhood. Okay, so from now, because I have very carefully designed basic notions, I am able to define more subtle notions without thinking anymore, without any additional work, because I just take the same definitions as in graphs. So because we have a notion of degree, we can define the degree distribution, the average degree, etc., but I don't detail here. And one important remark is that if the stream is a graph equivalent stream, so a stream with no dynamics, then the node degree is the same as the degree in the equivalent graph. And also we have relation with between average degree, the number of nodes, and the number of links in graphs, classical notions, and there are the same classical relations, I mean, and we have the same relations on streams. Going further, I will now define another very basic notion, which is the density, and that I will again use to define more elaborate notions, concepts. In the graph, the density is just the probability when I take two random nodes that these nodes are connected together. Or equivalently, it's the number of links in the graph divided by the number of possible links, as you probably know. In a stream, I take a very similar definition. I say that the density of a stream is the probability when I take two nodes and a random instant that these two nodes are linked together at this instant. Okay, and again, there is a formula for computing it that is just the number of links divided by the number of possible links, which is a little more intricate than for graph because you can have links only when there is a copresence between nodes. So I didn't write it on my slide. The important point is that when you have a graph equivalent stream again, then you obtain the graph density, and there is also relations, classical relations with number of nodes, links, and average degree that are preserved. Okay, and this is, in my sense, quite a simple and intuitive notion of density. And then, like in graphs, we can define quite a lot of notions more elaborate just from this concept, like cliques, for instance. A clique in a graph is just a subgraph of density 1, so a set of nodes that are all linked together directly, like the blue set of nodes here. And in a stream, I just define a clique as a substream of density 1, which means that, okay, so there is no work to introduce the definition because I already have substreams and density. There is a little work in interpreting it, maybe, understanding what it means, and it means that a clique is a set of nodes, like ABC here, and a time period such that all these nodes interact with each other constantly during this time period. Okay? So for instance, here, the red area is a clique in this stream, because ABC are linked together for all this time interval. And then, you can adapt graph clique algorithms into stream clique algorithms, etc. And it was already done by ourselves and colleagues. Likewise, another very classical notion in graph analysis is the clustering coefficient. The clustering coefficient is just the probability, the clustering coefficient of a node is the probability that two of its neighbors are connected together. So it's nothing but the density of the neighborhood of a node. So I don't have to think, and I don't have to work anymore to define it on a stream. I just say that because I have a notion of density, I have a notion of neighborhood. So I just say that the clustering coefficient of a node is the density of its neighborhood also in a stream graph. So I just detail the example here. You remember that I take the neighborhood of D, then I take the induced substream, and the clustering coefficient of D is just the density of this substream. And if you want an intuition on it, it's the probability when you take two neighborhoods of D at a given instant that they are linked together. Okay, another set of notions which have already been widely studied in previous works on streams is the wide set of path-related notions. notions, concepts defined from the concept of path. So I will just shortly introduce them here. In a graph J here, I've drawn a path from A to D, which is AB, BC, CD. And it has length 3, meaning that it has 3 hops. And of course, from this, you can define the notion of shortest path, which are paths with minimal length, not like the green one here. I'm presenting this because it's quite different in string graphs, because you take path from one node at a given time to another node at a given time. So here from 1D to 9C. And I've drawn a path in blue, which goes from D to B at time 2, from B to A at time 3, and then from A to B at time 7.5, and finally B to C from at time 8. Okay, and this path has length 4, because it makes 4 hops, and it has a duration, a difference of time between the departure time and the arrival time, which is 6. And as a consequence, we have two notions of distance, in some sense, a structural distance and a temporal distance, because we have some shortest path with minimal number of hops, and fastest path with minimal durations. Okay, and the fastest path is not necessarily the shortest path, and conversely. So there are basically two notions of distances, which has important consequences for the many notions that depends on that are defined from path. For instance, the bitterness centrality, which is a classical measurement of the importance of nodes in graphs, which is in a graph the fraction of shortest path in the whole graphs that that involve a given node. So the bitterness centrality of a node is the number of shortest paths that involve it. In a string graph, we define it in a very similar way by saying that the bitterness centrality of a node at a given time is a fraction of shortest fastest path. So among the fastest one, we take the shortest ones from any node at any time to any node at any time. That involves, of course, this node at this time. Okay. So I won't go further, but we have published online an archive preprint presenting the whole theory and like 40 or 50 pages of definitions like this with illustrations and examples. And we generalize many graph notions, including connectedness, key calls, etc. So I don't know if I have still maybe 1 minute. Just quite a philosophical consideration, maybe. This is of interest also for social sciences, where people are interested by the interplay between interactions and relations. The idea being that you have interaction, you interact with people you know, so you interact with your relations. So maybe interactions are induced by relations. So maybe a string graph is induced by an underlying graph. But conversely, you have relations with people you interact with. Okay, so interacting between someone regularly induces a relation between you. So maybe graphs are induced by string graphs and strings of interactions. So there is a kind of egg and chicken problem, saying that graphs come from relations come from interactions, and interactions come from relations. And of course, actually, there is coevolution of both, and until now we basically had only graphs, graph tools to discuss these questions in social sciences, and but now we have made some progress in this direction, at least we believe it, because we can deal with both objects with different formalisms and complementary formalisms, and maybe study the interplay between both. So in conclusion, we've defined a language in the sense of a set of concepts, a set of definitions that makes it rather easy to deal with interaction traces, that combines structure and dynamics in a consistent way. I didn't detail this, but actually there is a really equivalence between time and nonce in this formalism, but generalizes graphs, and we hope also to work further to generalize signal analysis. It raises new algorithmic challenges, of course. I introduced the Bitterness centrality, for instance, and we have no idea currently how to compute this, well, efficiently at least. We also worked on click algorithms and many other algorithms to compute the notion, the concepts we have introduced. And well, there are many interesting algorithmic concerns. And it also opens new perspective for data analysis because we can define features for groups of nodes during periods of time or for groups of links and things like this. And for instance, we work on event detection, for instance, or recommendation from such data using both the structure and the dynamics of interaction. And actually, we are working on various data sets, including internet traffic, financial transactions, where we are looking for frauds, mobility and contacts between individuals, mailing lists, sales, etc. So just an advertisement of calls for papers for two good international journals on these topics that we launched recently. Theoretical Computer Science with the title Link Streams, Models and Algorithms, and Computer Networks, Link Streams, Methods and Case Studies, with a deadline on the 1st of July. And you have a web page here with the calls for papers. Thank you for your attention. It's really the same question as would you describe a graph with degree distribution, clustering coefficient, correlation like this, rather than with a stochastic block model, for instance. So you really have different approaches. You have a statistics approach that
it's
when.
It's a very limited model, the Mark current process,
the general
model. Excuse me. But that's a very limited model, right? So if you stochastic block model is just one model, but then you have multivariate processes. It's a general object. You cannot say that. I don't see that.
Yes, sure. But when you have a data set that you want to describe, you want to compute some statistical properties. Actually, it's descriptive statistics of the object. You want to describe the properties of this object. And you have to, even when you make a model, you want to include these properties into your model. For instance, you want to generate a model with a given of a stream graph with given density or with given degree distribution. So you need to have a notion of degree distribution. And until now, we did not really have an appropriate notion for this, actually.
I'm slightly surprised because the data type you define as stream graphs seems to be isomorphic to having a simple graph and then a sequence of graph transformations with concrete embeddings. And in that data type, you would have basically just the complexity of a simple graph plus an discrete steps, so to speak, at time instances. And if I understand well, in biochemistry, for example, people use that compression to have efficiency on graphs of a million node size or something like this. Mm-hmm. And I think the latest is incremental update, where you would then incrementally change the counts, say, or certain properties. Is there a specific reason you want to sort of re-implement all the full detail of the same data? Is there a particular type of computation you have in mind why you wouldn't use graph rewriting?
No, for from an algorithmic perspective, for instance, it's not. Indeed, you can do basically. I don't know the words you're citing, but I know stream algorithms, for instance, streaming algorithmics, where you update the solution you have on the graph with node when you add a link or when you remove a link, and you're perfectly right that this case is clearly a specific case of streaming algorithms, for instance. So you could, one straight way to design, to obtain algorithms for dealing with stream graphs is to see them as a sequence of link addition or removals. But we can do better with these objects, actually. Because, for instance, when you take it as global, you know when you add a link, for instance, you know when the link arrives and when it ends. So it may be easier to compute some things. So this is one answer to, but you're right that streaming algorithms are very helpful for us because we use them as a first solution for stream computation. Another point that I could not detail is that some of the notions here are not, you cannot describe them in terms of properties of the graph at each time instant. Even simple notions like clicks, it's not just clicks. A subset of nodes that is a click at each time instant. It's not, okay, so I couldn't give the intuition on this, but it's not the same object. So in this case, you can't just use graph algorithms. So it depends on the case, but clearly in some cases it's true. In some other case, it's less clear.
I guess I'm asking, would you expect that by using a synergy between these techniques of transformation and your notion of, say, for example, these temporal clicks?
Yeah, sure.
I mean, I'm really asking about the implementation. I'm a bit worried about the efficiency because even in graph transformation engines, that's the limiting factor. How in time computation. Do you think maybe that could be a synergy between these updating algorithms and your stream?
Yeah, sure.
Because it seems you have a lot of that data carrying the time information of a node which is there, that is pretty much a static data until it's changed.
Sure.
I mean,
it's static until it changes. Yes. yes. Sure. There is a convergence between several areas of algorithms, actually, and the algorithmic question we ask here. Just there are really some differences. Like for the path, for instance, I presented the path. Computing shortest and fastest path in this kind of data is not cannot be reduced to computing path in graphs during time slices.
Right. Thank you.